Revelation 18, and we're going to look at the entire chapter here tonight, looking at the destruction of commercial Babylon. Now, this particular chapter is quite lengthy, and yet there's a lot of repetitive terminology in it, but it is here for a reason, to focus your attention upon what the Lord has done and what he is about to do. Verse 1. After these things, I saw another angel coming down from heaven, having great authority, and the earth was illuminated with his glory. And he cried mightily with a loud voice, saying, Babylon the great is fallen, and has become a habitation of demons, a prison for every foul spirit, and a cage for every unclean and hated bird. For all the nations have drunk of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. The kings of the earth have committed fornication with her, and the merchants of the earth have become rich through the abundance of her luxury. Now, in this particular chapter, there are four announcements by four different angels. And in this first announcement here, we have an angel declaring that Babylon is fallen. Now, for many of you that were with us in our last study, you're probably thinking, well, wait a minute, I thought Babylon fell in chapter 17. What are they talking about here? Well, chapter 17, we looked at religious Babylon. Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots. And we looked at the corrupt religious system of Babylon and how this particular system is to be destroyed by the kings of the earth. It's interesting in this particular chapter that the kings of the earth mourn over the destruction of commercial Babylon, where in chapter 7, the kings of the earth were the ones who destroyed religious Babylon. And so that makes a very clear distinction between these two chapters, just by the reaction of the kings of the earth. So you say, well, then chapter 17 is Mystery Babylon, the religious Babylon, the corrupt religious system that will come together in the last days. That's correct. And yet in chapter 18, we have the destruction of commercial Babylon. You say, well, what is the difference between the two? We remember back in chapter 13 of the book of Revelation, remember the beast, the Antichrist, was an individual who set in motion an economic system whereby no one could buy or sell anything unless they had a mark on their hand or on their forehead. Now, this particular system, of course, is an economic system. You can't buy or sell anything. So what would happen if you were the only bank in town and no one could buy or sell anything except through you? What would take place? Well, you would become incredibly wealthy, would you not? Because you see, on every transaction, your bank takes a cut, don't they? There's a percentage. That's why sometimes particular businesses don't want to take a credit card, because there is a cut that comes out of that transaction. Now, if every transaction that takes place in the world all takes place through his system, he and all those with him will become incredibly wealthy. And you will see this through this particular chapter. Now, Babylon, in this particular chapter and throughout the book of Revelation, is specifically described as a city. Let me just take you through some of these passages. Hold your finger here and turn back with me to chapter 14 and verse 8. chapter 14, verse 8, it says, "Then another angel followed, saying, 'Babylon is fallen, that great city, because she has made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication.'" Notice it says, "that great city." Very important little term. And then again in Revelation chapter 17, verse 18, right there at the end, it says, "The woman whom you saw is that great city which reigns over the kings of the earth." And then in chapter 18, verse 10, notice, "Standing at a distance for fear of her torment, saying, 'Alas, alas, that great city, Babylon, that mighty city, for in 1 hour your judgment has come.'" And again in verse 16, it's repeated again, "And saying, 'Alas, alas, that great city that was clothed in fine linen, purple and scarlet,'" and so on. Then verse 18, "And cried out when they saw the smoke of her burning, saying, 'What is like that great city?'" Verse 19. And it says, "They threw dust on their heads and cried out, weeping and wailing, and saying, 'Alas, alas, that great city, in which all who had ships on the sea became rich by her wealth.'" So notice that this particular judgment is coming on a very specific city, a city that does trade through merchants and merchant ships, that is very close to the ocean and will be able to facilitate that particular trade. This particular city we saw in our last study, and in the end of chapter 17, verse 18, "The woman whom you saw is that great city which reigns over the kings of the earth, which in the time of the writing of this was the city of Rome." Now, some people say, "Well, gosh, Steve, Rome is a city that sits, you know, inland in Italy." Yeah, but it's only 15 miles in from the Mediterranean Sea. And so it is very accessible. But this is the city that he is speaking of here. Babylon is also used by Peter as a code word for Rome in 1 Peter 5:13. There Peter ends his epistle and he says, "She who is in Babylon, elect together with you, greet you, and so does Mark my son." Now Peter is writing from Rome. The way we know this is because Mark is with him. In Paul's epistles, when he wrote from Rome, he mentions in the book of Colossians at the end, and also in Philemon, that Mark is with him there in Rome. So it is clear that Peter uses Babylon as kind of a code word for Christians, that they would understand that Rome is Babylon. Now, the scripture uses these kinds of words or terms for cities that go by another name. You remember back in chapter 11 of the book of Revelation, verse 8. Turn back there with me. Revelation 11, verse 8. It says that the two witnesses will be killed in the city of Jerusalem. It says their dead bodies will lie in the street of the great city, which spiritually is called Sodom and Egypt, where also our Lord was crucified. We know that Jesus was crucified in Jerusalem. And yet, here in the scripture, it is described as Sodom or Egypt because of the corruption that is in them. And so we have in this 18th chapter the destruction of commercial Babylon because of the incredible wealth that comes forth from this whole system that the Antichrist sets up. So let's look at these first couple of verses. Notice in verse 2, he says, "He cried mightily with a loud voice, 'Babylon the great is fallen, is fallen.'" Now notice that he describes this falling as though it had already occurred. The scripture does this many times in describing the destruction or the prophetic word that is coming forth. This is what's going to happen, but it's described in the sense that it's already completed, it's already done. Why does the scripture speak in that way? Babylon has not fallen. This was written 1900 years ago. It's not fallen yet, but this angel is declaring it is fallen. It is fallen. Because this prophecy is certain. The interpretation is sure. It will come to pass. Not one word that the Lord has spoken will be unfulfilled. Jesus said, not one jot or tittle will pass from my word until everything is fulfilled. And so you can be absolutely assured, and that's why it declares it in this way. Notice also the city has become the habitation of every foul spirit and every hateful bird. Now you say, what is that talking about? And remember, we talked about this image or this metaphor that is used throughout the scriptures of birds, all through the scriptures, that they denote that which is evil. In the parable of the mustard tree, where the tree grows up, the birds come and lodge in the branches of it. We looked at that last week. Now, that is a symbol of the church growing up into an unnatural growth, and then ultimately evil lodges within its branches. Here is another very good example proving that birds symbolically, metaphorically in Scripture are used for evil. And so they are described as the same as every foul spirit and the cage of every unclean and hated bird. Jesus also defined this particular term in the parable of the sower. This is another example and reason and proof why I believe that all birds are used in this manner in Scripture. In Matthew 13, he told the parable of the sower. The sower went out to sow, and he sowed some seed upon the wayside, some on the stony ground, some on the among thorns, and some on the good ground. Well, Jesus went on to interpret that he said, the seed that was sown on by the wayside, the birds of the air came and ate that seed. He then said in Matthew 13:19, he declared, when anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, then the wicked one comes and snatches away what was sown in his heart. And so Jesus interpreted the birds in his own parable as Satan himself. And so this is a pretty good foundation to believe that birds are what is referred to here. But notice, this city has become the habitation of every foul demonic spirit of the earth. And that is the reason why it is going to be destroyed. Now, note in the scripture, it says in Ephesians 2:22, just the opposite of you. It says concerning the church, you also are being built together for a habitation of God in the Spirit, or a dwelling place of God in the Spirit. And so this particular city is the habitation or dwelling place of every demonic evil that you can imagine. But the church of Jesus Christ is the habitation of God by way of the Holy Spirit. Isn't that a glorious thing to think of? The Lord joins his people together, and he inhabits our midst. He is here in the midst of us tonight, and he is walking about, and he is ministering to each one of us according to our need. Where two or three are gathered together in my name, Jesus said, there I am in the midst of them. What an awesome blessing. Now this judgment comes upon this city because it has polluted the entire world with her fornication. Notice verse 3. For all the nations have drunk of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. The kings of the earth have committed fornication with her, and the merchants of the earth have become rich through the abundance of her luxury. So notice that there is the description of riches here, the abundance of riches, and all nations have been made to drink of the wine of this fornication. Now, what is this talking about? Obviously, this is talking in a spiritual sense. Fornication or adultery in Scripture is always used in, again, a metaphor for a person prostituting their love and their service from God to something else. Any kind of idolatry is always seen as spiritual fornication or spiritual adultery. And so if a person has not made a commitment to Christ, that's spiritual fornication. If they have made a commitment to Christ, it's spiritual adultery because they've already made a marital commitment. Do you see the reasoning and the different use of terminology? And so here in our text, we see that all nations have drank of her wine, the wine of the wrath of her fornication. Now, in the spiritual sense, Babylon was the source and the origin of all corrupt religious practice that we see on the earth today. Babylon was the source of all idolatry, magic, witchcraft, spiritism, astrology, and all corrupt religion, whether it is Catholic, Protestant, or whoever it is. Wherever you find corrupt religion, it is the result of the corruption that first started in Babylon. If you go back again, I will repeat this from our previous study in Genesis 11. There, Nimrod was the first man who rebelled against God politically, and it was the center of economic rebellion against God and the center of religious rebellion against God. He was the one who built the city of Babel that later became the city of Babylon. And so there is where it all began. After the flood, he was the first one that the scripture declares rebelled against the Lord. And that's where they built the Tower of Babel and so on, in rebellion against the Lord. And yet Babylon is also pictured here as intoxicating the world with their economic system and the promise of pleasure, the promise of luxury, and get behind this program, get your mark, and get in line to receive the benefits of it. And all of the nations of the world will drink of the wine of this fornication. Why? Because they have to. They either do so or they are put to death. There's no in between. And so this is the program of the Antichrist, the one who will rule the earth during that last 7-year period of time here on the earth. Now, it's interesting here that, I mean, for us as believers, we are encouraged not to become adulterers or adulteresses. We are not to love the world. And this is always the exhortation that comes to the people of God from the beginning of time to our present time. Read with me this next announcement by the next angel here in verse 4. And notice the message that is declared. And I heard another voice from heaven saying, come out of her, my people. Who? My people. Lest you share in her sins, lest you receive of her plagues. For her sins have reached to heaven, and God has remembered her iniquities. Render to her just as she rendered to you, and repay her double according to her works. In the cup which she has mixed, mix for her double. In the measure that she glorified herself and lived luxuriously, in the same measure give her torment and sorrow. For she says in her heart, I sit as queen and am no widow, and will not see sorrow. Therefore her plagues will come in one day, death and mourning and famine, and she will be utterly burned with fire, for strong is the Lord God who judges her. So this particular angel here makes a very clear plea to God's people to come out of her. Come out of this commercial harlotry, this commercial Babylon. You say, well, how do you apply that? What does that really mean? It means do not love the world. That's what it means. It's a simple exhortation. Jesus gave it in his ministry. He said, no man can serve two masters. You either hate one and love the other, or you despise one and serve the other. He said, you cannot serve God and mammon, which is the god of power, the god of money. You can't do it. It's impossible. And so the exhortation for every believer is not to get caught in loving this world. It says in 1 John 2:15 and 16, do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. So the commercial Babylon is just the world system that promotes lust, that says you can have it all. You have this thing. I mean, that's what Madison Avenue is all about. That's what Wall Street is all about. It is promoting this philosophy. And I'll tell you, there are many that drink of the wine of this fornication. And it can't give you satisfaction. It can't give you life. It can't give you what it promises. The scripture tells us that, well, pleasure is a very fleeting thing. The Bible doesn't say that sin is not pleasurable. It is. But it is only for a season. And the end of that is always death. And so if you want, you know, Moses made that decision not to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season, but rather to suffer affliction with the people of God. Now, that was a wise choice. You know what? Every believer has to make that choice. And I'll tell you, when persecution comes to the United States, if we are still here during that time, every one of us in this room is going to have to make that decision. We're going to have to choose. We're going to have to say, do I want to flow here with the program, or do I want to stand for Christ? And if you stand for Christ, well, you're going to be in trouble. You're going to have some difficulty. You're going to have some sorrow. And so it's a decision that you have to make. But you have to make that decision today as well. Every single day you have to make that decision. Where are you looking for life? Where are you looking for joy, peace, satisfaction, fulfillment, meaning in your life? Where? You're going to look either to this world and its system, or you're going to look to the Lord. If you're looking to the Lord, you're going to be seeking his face every single morning you wake up. That's what you're going to do. Because you know there is no life in whatever job you do. There's no life in my job. And I'm here every single day. No life in it. In fact, there's plenty of sorrow in it. There's only life in the Lord. It's the only place you're going to find life. So, you know, when people say, oh, it's easy for you to say, Steve, you don't work at my job. Well, I can say the same. You don't work at my job. But I'll tell you, the result is always the same. There's life only in Christ. Oh, if I could just be there, if I could just do that full time, oh, everything would be fine. Oh, no, it wouldn't. Guaranteed. You have to still find your life in the Lord Jesus Christ. That's it. Now, notice this exhortation here is come out of her. Come out of her. All through Scripture, you see this message. You see the message first in Genesis 12 to Abraham. What did God say to him? Come out. Come out from among the idolaters in the land of Ur. Come into a land that I will show you, and I will make of you a great nation, and I'll bless you. That's God's promise to him. He tells the same thing to the Jews. He says, come out of Egypt, and I will bless you and take you and put you in your own land, and I will bless you there. God says the same thing to every one of us as believers. In 2 Corinthians 6:17, there Paul said, come out from among them and be separate, says the Lord. Do not touch what is unclean, and I will receive you, and I will be a father to you, and you will be my sons and daughters, saith the Lord. What a promise. We have to come out from this world system. In Ephesians 5:11, there Paul says, have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather expose them. And so there is this constant exhortation to us all, come out. Now, what is the reason for this separation? Well, notice it's twofold here. He says, come out from her, my people, lest you share in her sins, lest you receive of her plagues. You see, if you share or partake in her sin, then you will partake in her judgment as well. And that is something that God does not want for any of his people. He wants us to have a heart that's separate. Now, that does not mean we are to be separate, but not in some kind of isolation. Now, those that followed in the becoming monks and, you know, in the years and centuries before us, their belief was that they had to come completely out and live completely separate. And that is not God's intention. He sends his disciples where? Into a monastery? No. He sends them into the world to preach the gospel. That's where he sends them. And God does not want us to isolate ourselves. Isolation is not his plan. Separation is his plan. And so you can be separate, but not isolated. And there is a great difference between the two. Now notice here that she is to receive judgment. Notice the basis upon which she is judged. For her sins have reached to heaven, God has remembered her iniquities. Notice, this is the basis upon which he judges this world commercial system that has traded in everything and anything to make money. Isn't that amazing? I mean, what the world will sell and buy to make money. I mean, here, gosh, I think it was about, oh, probably 10 years ago, there was an article on what were called sin stocks. You can profit from commercial enterprises that are called sin stocks. Did you ever hear about that? It was quite an expose in a couple of magazines about it and so on. And anything that has to do with sin, the pornography industry, you know, liquor industry, anything that promotes sin, you need to buy into those companies because this is where you can make a bundle. I mean, you think of the heart and mind that thought that up. And, you know, for somebody who's looking for short-term gain, it might be a wise thing to do. For a long-term gain, it's the most foolish thing to do because if you partake in her sin, than you will receive of her plagues. Now notice here it says that God remembers her sin. Just the opposite of what God says he will do with your sin. Think about that. God says, your sin I will remember no more. What a glorious promise is that. But this sin will be remembered, and he will remember every single sin. And the basis of that remembrance is the basis of his judgment. Notice, he goes on here to declare, render to her just, verse 6, just as she rendered to you. In fact, repay her double according to her works in the cup which she has mixed for her double, in the measure that she glorified herself and lived luxuriously. In the same measure, give her torment and sorrow. You know, Jesus proclaimed this same basis of judgment. He said in Matthew 7, verse 1 and 2, he said, judge not that you be not judged, for with what judgment you judge, you will be judged. And with the measure you use, it will be measured back to you. With that statement, that should make every one of us as Christians very careful when we make judgments of others. And when you find yourself doing it, repent. Ask the Lord to forgive you and change your heart, because you know your heart is off. You're in the wrong place. You are in the flesh. So when you hear that thought go through your mind, who do they think they are? Repent. Because in the same measure that you judge, it's going to come back your way one day. I guarantee you. If it hasn't yet, just wait. It will. Now notice that I want to bring one item out here about this issue of God's judgment. A good passage for you to read on this, if you're note takers, take this verse down and read it maybe later. It's Hosea 5, verses 12 and verse 14. It describes the way God judges. Here in Revelation 18, we have the Lord, just wasting this city in one day and one hour. He just wipes it off the map, as we'll see as we continue to read here. But God doesn't always judge that way. Sometimes he judges, the scripture says, as a lion. Just tears somebody to pieces. It's done. He tears a nation to pieces. It's done. Other times he judges, it says, like a moth that just slowly eats and destroys. So judgment comes two ways. And it's not always something that you see take place, but God is dealing. Sometimes slowly, sometimes, like a lion. And here we have only this one example in our text here this evening. But God's judgment comes. Now, notice he says here at the end of verse 8, and she will be utterly burned with fire, for strong is the Lord who judges her. Now, many times people count God's patience as weakness. They say, God isn't going to do anything. All these, statements and warnings and, this is going to happen and that's going to happen. I don't even see anything happen. I've been sinning like crazy for years. Nothing's happened to me. So what do I think? It's not going to happen. Well, God's patience is incredible. It is. Don't ever take it for weakness. It says in 2 Peter chapter 3 that he is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. That's why he waits. That's why he does not judge immediately. He has a patient heart. And so for the person who thinks they're getting away with it, they are not getting away with it. It will be dealt with because, notice he says here, strong is the Lord God who judges her. He is a powerful guy. And boy, I'm telling you, the scripture says it's a fearful thing to fall into the hands of a living God, because he is a real guy. And when you see what he has done throughout the centuries, through the pages of scripture, I'm telling you, if he created all that we see every night and every morning when we wake up, then he is one strong guy. And we better not think that he is a weakling. He's not. And so God is strong enough to take care of this judgment. Verse 9 through 19, the third lamentation of this angel. And the kings of the earth who committed fornication and lived luxuriously with her will weep and lament for her when they see the smoke of her burning, standing at a distance for fear of her torment, saying, "Alas, alas, that great city, Babylon, that mighty city, for in 1 hour your judgment has come." And the merchants of the earth will weep and mourn over her, for no one buys their merchandise anymore. Merchandise of gold and silver and precious stones and pearls, fine linen and purple, silk and scarlet, every kind of citron wood, every kind of object of ivory, every kind of object of the most precious wood, bronze, iron, and marble, and cinnamon, and incense, and fragrant oil, and frankincense, wine and oil, fine flour, and wheat, and cattle, sheep, and horses, and chariots, and bodies, and souls of men. Interesting. We're going to come back to that one. And the fruit that your soul longed for has gone from you. Their luxury, their relaxation, their pleasure from their wealth. The fruit that your soul longed for has gone from you, and all the things which are rich and splendid have gone from you, and you have found them no more at all. The merchants of these things who become rich by her will stand at a distance for fear of her torment, weeping and wailing and saying, "Alas, alas, that great city that was clothed in fine linen and purple and scarlet and adorned with gold and precious stones and pearls. For in 1 hour such great riches came to nothing. And every shipmaster, all who traveled by ship, sailors, and as many as trade on the sea, stood at a distance and cried out when they saw the smoke of her burning, saying, 'What is like this great city?' And they threw dust on their heads and cried out, weeping and wailing and saying, 'Alas, alas, that great city in which all who had ships on the sea became rich by her wealth, for in 1 hour she is made desolate.'" It's interesting here that these merchants, these kings, they were all getting a cut, you see, of every one of these transactions. And they all lament because they're not getting that, all that their soul longed for in verse 14. It's all disappeared. And their means of prosperity has gone up in smoke. Now, it's interesting here that this is an obvious, visible judgment that everyone can see. It's a judgment that is obviously incredibly terrible because no one wants to go anywhere near the city. And it says here, for fear, verse 15, they stand at a distance for fear of her torment. The torment that was inflicted upon her, there's something that they're afraid of. And so they don't go near him. Now, this judgment is so different from anything that you will read about in history or even in the scripture. It's a judgment that comes in 1 hour. Now, they besieged the city of Jerusalem for years. Every time they sought to take it, whatever country came against it. I mean, Tyre was besieged by Alexander the Great for 13 years before they took the city. And finally, they destroyed it. Do you know what happens when people destroy a city? They go in and they plunder it. They go in and take the plunder, the booty. So why don't they, does anybody want to go in and plunder the city? Many commentators think that this is a nuclear explosion. And I think that's a very real possibility. But you know what? The Lord doesn't need any atom bomb. He can take care of this kind of destruction himself. He already did it with Sodom and Gomorrah, right? So it doesn't have to be some, atomic reaction and explosion where people obviously don't want to go anywhere near because of the radiation. But all I can say to you is that this destruction is sure, it's quick, it's obvious, it's visible. Everybody clearly understands this is over. This is done. This visible judgment is all because they looked for a fruit. And I believe in verse 14 it says, the fruit that your soul longed for has gone from you. Notice all of the things that are listed before this from verse 11 through 13. All of the items that they trafficked in. And the last of which are called the bodies and the souls of men. Interesting. Slavery, yet the worst of slavery is when somebody exchanges their soul for access to this commercial Babylon. What did Jesus mean when he said in Matthew 16:26, "For what profit is it to a man if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul? Or what will a man give in exchange for his soul?" Well, many exchange their soul for a moment's pleasure. They exchange their soul for wealth, power, position. And it happens every single day. So have you made that decision to give your soul to him and to him alone? That's the key. That is the only thing that makes any sense to me. In 1 hour, it all comes to naught. Now, and also, let me say one thing. Some have thought that this, after the World Trade Centers were hit, they thought that this particular prophecy was fulfilled by that. I do not believe that. Specifically because the world commercial Babylon is still in progress today. And this is talking about a final judgment, as we'll see in just a minute. Then the fourth angel declares, verse 20, "Rejoice over her, O heaven, and you holy apostles and prophets, for God has avenged you on her." Then a mighty angel took up a stone like a great millstone. Notice, like a great millstone, and threw it into the sea, saying, "Thus with violence the great city Babylon shall be thrown down and shall not be found anymore." Now notice how many times the word "anymore" is used here and repeated. "The sound of the harpists and musicians, flautists and trumpeters shall not be heard in you anymore. No craftsman or any craft shall be found in you anymore. And the sound of a millstone shall not be heard in you anymore. And the light of the lamp shall not shine in you anymore. The voice of the bridegroom and the bride shall not be heard in you anymore." No one will get married. "For your merchants were the great men of the earth, for by your sorcery all nations were deceived. And in her was found the blood of prophets and saints, and of all who were slain on the earth." Now notice here that God here is declaring from heaven to rejoice over her destruction. Now, it's important, I think, to note here that it is not in the we should not be rejoicing here, or would we rejoice in the destruction of men. We are rejoicing here that God's justice has been satisfied. Notice the last little phrase there in verse 20, "For God has avenged." It is God's justice that has prevailed here, which will prevail. Now, I believe that this is important because the scripture tells us not to avenge ourselves or not to have wrath upon others. It says in Romans chapter 12, verse 19, "Beloved, do not avenge yourselves, but rather give place to wrath, for it is written, 'Vengeance is mine, I will repay, saith the Lord.'" So the Lord is the one who repays. And if you allow him to do that, he will. And here he does. He repays. And that's why we should rejoice, because justice, God's justice, has prevailed. And I think that when a person can't see the righteousness of that rejoicing, it's because your mind has been, well, tainted by the view of this world, that you can't rejoice in justice and righteousness. And I'll tell you, that's what is needed upon this earth. I can't rejoice when justice does not prevail and unrighteousness prevails. I can't rejoice in that. I will rejoice when justice prevails. Notice the use of the millstone here, I think, is quite appropriate. Remember what Jesus said in Matthew 18:6. It says, "Whoever causes one of these little ones who believe in me to sin, it would be better for him if a millstone were hung around his neck and he were drowned in the depths of the sea." Now he's talking about one individual offending one of his children and stumbling them. Here he's talking about a whole commercial system of this world who stumbles and robs and rips off the souls of men. Stumbling them will be cast into the sea with a millstone around their necks, for sure. This word "anymore" speaks of the finality of this judgment. It's final. There's no turning back. Notice also this particular word here at the end of verse 23. "For by your sorcery all the nations were deceived." This word, sorcery, is a Greek word that literally means it's the Greek word pharmakia. It's where we get our word pharmacy, pharmaceuticals. It's the use of drugs. It's interesting that he describes here the pursuit of wealth like a drug that someone takes. Think of that. Now, money is not bad. Money is not evil. But the love of money, the pursuit of wealth for wealth alone, is the root of all kinds of evil. And that is what he's describing here. It's like a drug that intoxicates a person. I have seen people taking this drug, and they will destroy everything. They will destroy their entire family because they are intoxicated with this drug. Be careful, because it can happen to you. Now, I like here that the whole point of this, and I just want to kind of sum this up. Chapter 17 is the destruction of religious Babylon. Chapter 18 is the destruction of economic and commercial Babylon. Do you know what happens in chapter 19? It's the destruction of political Babylon. Because in Revelation 19, verse 15, it says, "Now out of his mouth goes a sharp sword, that with it he will strike the nations." Not just a city now, the nations as a whole. And so now here we have the Battle of Armageddon take place in chapter 19, and political Babylon, and the political head of that Babylon, the Antichrist, will come to naught. And so, I could hardly wait to get to chapter 19. Because this is the end of the story. This is the victory and the ultimate end. I love this because religious Babylon has destroyed so many people. Economic Babylon has destroyed just as many. And political Babylon. You know that the corrupt religious system throughout history is the biggest persecutor of godly people on this earth. It is. This is why he ends this chapter with, "In her was found the blood of the prophets and the saints and all who were slain on the earth." But you know what? Economic Babylon is also a great persecutor of the saints of God. One of the best examples of that is in Acts chapter 19. Remember when the silversmiths who were making their livelihood off of the goddess Diana, remember what happened? They said, when Paul said, "These are not gods." Well, these guys got pretty bent out of shape and they said, "We're going to kill you because you're ripping off our livelihood, the way we are making money off of people." Notice, it was an economic motivation. But politically as well. Sometimes nations have destroyed God's people. There's no religious basis for it, no economic basis for it. China and Russia are probably two very good examples who persecute the Church of Jesus Christ. And only up until 1990, I mean, when we went in there in 1992, I'll tell you, those people were so hungry, it was amazing. For 70 years, I mean, they were persecuted. I sat and talked to pastors who had been persecuted for handing out tracts. One who went to prison for 13 years for handing out a tract at his place where he worked, the factory that he worked in. I'll tell you, religious Babylon, economic Babylon, and political Babylon are one day coming to an end. So make sure you're in the kingdom of God. Amen? Let's go to him in prayer.